Hi everyone. Today's video is about developing your study. I'm your professor, Dr. Jenny Rozier. Let's get started. When you're trying to work on your research project, it always helps me to think about a checklist. So let's move down our checklist. Hopefully you've already picked a topic and you've started finding some previous research, or you at least know where to look for the previous research. Maybe, again, hopefully, but maybe you've formed your hypotheses already. You can look at the assignment description for a really great explanation on how to form hypotheses, in addition to the hypotheses lectures that you've already looked at. And then you need to start naming and defining variables. Now, it might feel like you've already named your variables because you have the hypotheses. So, clearly you know what your variables are going to be. But in this lecture, I'm really going to flesh out what it means to name, like what variables are and what it means to name them and define them. In a later video, we'll talk about picking a study design and creating your manipulations and measurements. So what are variables? Variables are any entity that can take on a value. So it's important that you understand what isn't a variable and what is a variable. So for example, hair, just saying hair, is not a variable. But saying colors of hair, something that takes on a value, right? There's different values in colors of hair, like black hair, brown hair, blonde hair, red hair, gray hair, white hair, right? There's different colors, green, purple, orange, or texture of hair, or length of hair, or I don't even know, coarseness of hair, curliness of hair, something like that would be a variable. Just saying hair is not a variable. In the same respect, saying support is a variable is not, is your variable, is actually not a variable. We have to talk about what you mean about support. What kind of values are you going to place on it? So effectiveness of support, sensitivity of support, quality of support, length of support, time of day of support, something like that, something that can take on a value. Variables help researchers understand differences and relationships. When we talk about differences, variables help researchers understand if there is a difference between the levels of one variable on a second variable. So if there's a difference in the levels of the independent variable on a dependent variable. Now, in several videos that I make, I will talk about pets, different pet types and pet coolness and things like that are my variables often in hypotheses. And the reason for that is I have four children, and our four children never had a pet until we moved into our current house that we live in right now. We moved in several years ago, well, like 3 years ago. And when we moved in, we had always told them that when we moved into a new house, we would get a pet. And so, like I said, we have four children. They're all very competitive. They all have their own ideas. And there were lots of pet ideas that were thrown into the mix. My oldest son wanted a dog very bad. His twin sister wanted a cat or a pig or a hamster really bad. My second son, so under the twins, he always wanted a duck or a pig. And our youngest son wanted a cat or a dog. And so in many of my videos, you'll hear me talk about one pet being a cooler pet than the other pets. And the reason for this is because this was their argument. So they made this argument many, many times. My daughter would say, "Oh, come on, Mom, come on, Dad. Cats are way cooler pets than dogs or pigs or ducks." Whereas our son Paxton, who wanted a duck very badly, he would constantly say, "Oh my gosh, ducks are way cooler than snakes and dogs and cats. Mom, we have to get a duck. In the end, we ended up getting a dog. And they still harp on us all the time about all those other pets that they wanted. So if you're wondering where that idea comes from, that's where it comes from. So here's my sample hypothesis. Snakes are cooler pets than dogs and cats. Here, we're looking to see if there's a difference in the levels of one variable, the one variable being pet type, dogs, snakes, cats, right? So we're looking to see if there's a difference in the levels of the one variable on the second variable, ratings of pet coolness. So we're looking to see, is there a difference in coolness ratings between dogs, snakes, and cats? Variables can also help researchers understand relationships. So is there a relationship between two variables? And when we talk about linear relationships, which is what we're going to talk about in this class, there's other kinds of relationships. But in this class, we're really going to talk about linear. There's only three. So positive, negative, and neutral, or no relationship. A positive relationship states that as one variable increases, the other variable also increases. Or as one variable decreases, the other variable also decreases. The variables move in the same direction. When one changes, the other also changes in the same direction. A negative relationship, though, is that as one variable increases, the other variable decreases. Here they move in opposite directions. As one increases, the other decreases. As one decreases, the other increases. The interesting thing here is when we talk about relationship, or when we talk about variables that help researchers understand differences, we're talking about causation. A change in one variable causes a change in another variable. When we talk about how variables help researchers understand relationships, we're talking about correlation. As one variable changes, the other variable also changes. We don't know which one causes a change in the other. We just know that as one changes, the other one changes as well. A neutral relationship is where there's no relationship between the variables. So in addition to variables helping researchers understand differences and relationships, there's also two different differentiations that I'm going to talk about in regards to variables. So first we have concrete variables versus abstract variables. Concrete variables are consistent, they're stable, they don't change over time. So this would be something like birth order. No matter how many children your parents have, if you were the firstborn, you're always going to be the firstborn. And if you were the secondborn, you're always going to be the secondborn, etc. So birth order is something that's stable and it doesn't tend to change. Most variables are not concrete. Abstract variables can change over time or can change from situation to situation. So think about the quality of your communication competence. I hope, especially as a comm major, that you feel more communicatively competent now than you did, say, 4 years ago. Your communication competence has likely changed over time. Similarly, you might feel more competent in one kind of situation or context and less competent in another kind of situation or context. So, for example, I feel pretty communicatively competent when I am speaking in front of an audience or in my interpersonal interactions with my friends and family and romantic partners. But sometimes I feel less competent when I am trying to communicate with my children, to be honest. It can be really difficult to figure out how to communicate with children sometimes. And that would be one area where I feel a little less competent. Some of you might feel less competent in places like a job interview or when speaking to someone in an authority role to you. Or you might have more trouble talking with friends or talking with romantic partners. Regardless of where you feel more or less competent, that is an example of an abstract variable. Another differentiation that I'd like you to understand is independent versus dependent. So an independent variable is thought to cause a change in the dependent variable. The independent variable is manipulated. The researcher manipulates it, or sometimes, as we'll learn later, participants might place themselves in an independent variable category. But an independent variable causes a change in another variable, and it's manipulated. The dependent variable is measured, and it is thought to be changed by the independent variable. In this class, independent variables are often categorical, and dependent variables are often continuous. And I think that'll make a little bit more sense in the next couple of minutes. Now that you understand what variables are, it's really important that you understand the variable levels. Now, these are words that you probably haven't heard before: nominal, ordinal, interval, ratio. But they are going to be terms that you are going to need to understand the rest of the semester. I plan to talk about them next, but also I will post a couple more videos in the weekly folder that maybe could help you understand them a little better. They were videos that were made by my students in past years, and so I hope that they can help you maybe in a different way than I can. The most important thing for you to remember when you're thinking about variable levels is that they build on one another. And so if you can remember the order of them, it can always help you figure out what kind of variable or what kind of level a variable is. So nominal is first, then ordinal, then interval, then ratio. Nominal has a certain number of characteristics. Ordinal has all of the characteristics of nominal and then a new characteristic. Interval has all of the characteristics of nominal and ordinal and a new characteristic. I hope this makes sense. So when you're trying to think about, what kind of variable is this, which could be an exam question, go in order and go down the list. Does it meet all of these criteria? Yes. Okay, move to the next one. Does it meet these criteria? Yes. Move to the next one. It doesn't? Well, then it was the first one. The first level of variables is called nominal. Nominal variables are categorical. So they're considered discrete variables. They have a beginning and an end, and it is categorical. They're in groups. The levels are in groups. So they can be differentiated only on the basis of type, and they cannot be rank ordered. So you cannot put them in order of better to worse, or top to bottom, or more to less. There's no rank ordering at all. A great example of a nominal variable that we actually already mentioned in this video is hair color. You can't rank order hair color, and it is categorical. So we would have white hair, gray hair, blonde hair, brown hair, red hair, black hair. So maybe we would have 6 nominal categories, and we would just ask people, what is your hair color? And you would check a participant would check a box on which hair color they have. We're not rank ordering them. There's no right or wrong order of them. There's no ranking. And their categories. Now, when you are creating categories, there's 3 rules that you have to follow. Categories must be equivalent. This is, all categories should be about the same attribute. So let's go back to our hair color example. You can't say, please indicate your hair color, and then you have, let's say we're only interested in 3 hair colors, just to make it really easy, okay? So you can't say, please indicate your hair color, and then have blonde, brunette, white, curly. Curly is not equivalent to the other categories. So you have to make sure that all of the categories that you have are actually about your variable. They must be mutually exclusive. So every observation will fit into one and only one of the categories. This can be difficult if people have multiple hair colors. you know, if people have highlights and they're like, well, I guess I have black hair, but I also have gray highlights, or I have brown hair and I also have blonde highlights, so I don't know which one to pick. An easy way to help your participants in this situation is to have an other category. It also helps the last rule of categories is that they must be exhaustive. Every observation should have a category. So you wouldn't want someone to come to your study and they see, what is your hair color? And the only choices, I don't remember what my choices were a minute ago. Maybe I think I said gray, black, and blonde. So if those are your only choices and someone has brown hair, they're like, I don't fit in one of these categories. Having that other option will help solve this problem. Okay, so this is where the building part happens. Ordinal variables have all of the same characteristics as nominal. They're categories, and you have to have all those rules. But now they can be rank ordered. Okay, so it has all of the characteristics of nominal, and now we rank order them. So you can't, the problem here though is you can rank order them, but you can't see the difference between the rankings. So this is where you might say first, second, third, right? If someone comes in first place in a race and someone else comes in second place in a race, you know that the second place person came in after the first place person. But just saying first and second place doesn't tell you how much farther behind second place was to first place. They could have been 1 second behind, or they could have been 10 minutes behind. So we can rank order them. We can rank order the categories, but we don't know the magnitude of the difference between the categories. A really common example in research is whenever you give people a range. So if you've ever taken a survey before and the survey asks you to indicate your income level, your household income, they never say indicate your income level and you just write out how much money you make. Instead, it says please indicate the income bracket that you fall in. And so it might say like 0 to 50,000, 51,000 to 100,000, 101,000 to 150,000, and you check a box. Now we know that the person who chose the first box, 0 to 50,000, makes less money than the person who chose the second box, right? We know they make less money than the person who chose the second box, which was 51,000 to 100. But we don't know how much the difference is. The person who chose the first box could have chosen it because they only make $1,000 a year, or they could have chosen it because they made $50,000 a year. And the other person could have chosen the second box because they made $51,000 or $55,000 or $99,000. So we understand the order of things, but we don't know the magnitude of the difference between those categories. Interval is a really common variable level. Here we have the categories still. We can rank order them. And now we know the magnitude of the difference between the levels. So the most common kind of interval variable is measured with a Likert scale. So a Likert scale is the most common kind of scale that you've probably taken in a survey. So this is where it might say like, I am happy with my life. Strongly disagree to strongly agree. So strongly disagree is 1. Disagree is 2, neutral is 3, agree is 4, strongly agree is 5, right? So we can say that the person who chose 4 is exactly 1 unit below the person who chose 5. I understand what you're probably thinking though. How do we know that the person who chose 4 and the person who chose 5 are choosing those numbers meaning the same thing in their head, or even 2 people that both chose 4. How do we know they mean the same thing? Well, we don't. But researchers have come to an agreement that a Likert scale is an interval level of measurement, that the people who chose 2 all mean about the same thing, and the people who chose 4 all mean about the same thing. So if you see a Likert scale, you know for sure it is an interval level variable. The last level is called ratio. So ratio variables are categories that can be rank ordered, and we know the magnitude of the difference between them, but now we have a true zero point. The best example for me for ratio measurement or ratio variable is if you're counting something, because a ratio variable indicates that there could be an absence of something. Now, if it's measured with a Likert scale, it might sound, when you hear the variable name, it might sound like there could be a zero or a lack of the variable. But if it's measured with a Likert scale, it's interval all the time. If it's measured with the Likert scale, it's always interval. So ratio would be something like, let's say that your variable was number of albums on Facebook. You could count those. And yes, somebody could have zero albums. Or number of pens a person owns. You could count those, and people could own zero pens. Temperature, even though it has a negative point, is considered a ratio variable. And exam scores or test scores, those have a zero point. Those are considered ratio. Age, even though we never say that someone is 0 years old or my baby is zero, we consider that to be a ratio variable. We assume that there is a true zero point. Well, that's a wrap. I'm Dr. Jenny Rozier, Associate Professor of Communication Studies at James Madison University. I'm also the director of the RLH Project. You can find me on Instagram at RelationshipsLoveHappiness or on Facebook at / RelationshipsLoveHappiness. Thanks for watching.